So just to give you a little bit of background to the Corem activity, it's a strategic investment by the Department of Chemistry to bring together a number of researchers in various areas of plastic electronics, predominantly synthetic chemistry and computational chemistry. I was fortunate enough to be invited to join the group in, so I have a part-time appointment here. And we're gradually putting together an activity that hopefully will cover most aspects of organic electronics, from synthesis to device development, all the way through to computational simulations of both materials and devices. And so this is really our inaugural meeting, and it's an opportunity hopefully for the members of Corem to introduce their research to the external speakers, and also for all of us within Corem to learn a little bit about what's going on outside of NTNU. So I hope it will be an enjoyable meeting. I'm certainly looking forward to it. Bjorn has done virtually all of the organisation, so he should probably be here introducing all of this to you, and I'm sure he'll talk to you later about some other aspects of Corem. But in the meantime, welcome to everybody. I'm looking forward to the meeting. I hope you enjoy it. And it's my great pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Professor John Anthony, who's the J.C. Hubbard Professor of Professor in the Department of Chemistry at the University of Kentucky. John is one of the foremost synthetic chemists in the field of molecular semiconductors, and is perfect person, I think, to kick off the meeting. So, John.
Right, thank you, John.
See if I can get this one right.
Over the years,
there we are. I'll do my best to keep my voice down. So, thank you for the invitation to talk at this inaugural meeting. It's very exciting what you're doing here. Let's get started. Okay, we'll wake up the screen. There we are. Just takes a moment. So, I'm from the University of Kentucky. I'm not a native of the state. I'm originally from San Diego, so I say I'm from San Diego, but I work in Kentucky. Nice thing about doing this in its native format is rather than a laser pointer where I have to point at one screen, when I point, it shows up on both screens. So it makes life a lot easier. So just a little introduction, since very few people here, except for maybe John, have ever been to Kentucky or even know where it is. We're in the middle of the U.S. in what's frequently referred to as flyover territory. And the most famous thing probably is Kentucky Fried Chicken. Most everyone knows about that. Well, there's a lot more going on in Kentucky. I thought I'd introduce a few things. First of all, we have horse races. That's one of the big industries. The Kentucky Derby is the most famous horse race in the U.S., but that's not where I live. That's Louisville. That's 100 kilometers to the west. Where I live is where the horses are all raised. And this, and John can back me up, this is basically my commute to work. I drive by this. Horse farms, the beautiful animals out there. Bourbon. If you have bourbon, it is most likely from Kentucky. But the interesting aspect about that is that if I draw a map of Kentucky, and these are all the counties, we have 120 counties in an area probably smaller than the area of Norway. And these in red are all the counties where it is illegal to purchase alcohol. Even Bourbon County, where most of the bourbon is made, it is illegal to purchase. They have to ship it out of the area before they can actually sell it. We grow a lot of tobacco, burley tobacco, and the Corvette is manufactured in Bowling Green, Kentucky. All of them are made in Kentucky. So if you like gambling on racehorses, drinking bourbon if you're in the right area, smoking and driving fast cars, Kentucky is a great place. And I can't help but bring up sort of the recent politics, because Kentucky was the first state to declare it was going for Trump. Okay, that's where I live. I will notice that the two areas marked in blue are the two areas that have universities in them. And so it's not my fault. I tried. The other thing we have a lot of in Kentucky is coal. And in fact, the state legislature is trying to pass a law stating that the only method of power generation in Kentucky will be burning coal. And so you can buy this license plate for your car. Coal keeps the lights on. Whatever you think of that, the lovely thing about coal is that it's full of polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, and that's where the synthetic chemist comes in and has a wonderful time. And so if we think about a sheet of graphene, there are a number of ways we can partition graphene into different types of subunits. They each have their own names and classifications. We focus on the linearly fused hydrocarbons. So these are called the acenes. And it's nice talking to a chemistry audience because I don't have to introduce the Clar aromatic sextet. So the way Clar defined an acene is that it is the fused aromatic system where no matter how many fused rings there is only one aromatic sextet, right? So I can draw one sextet, everything else is butadienes basically, right? Which means that as the ring gets longer and longer, that aromatic stability is delocalized over more and more area. It becomes weaker. Okay, so one of the most infuriating things if you read the literature is people will call these acenes. I don't know, I see four aromatic sextets. This is not an acene, period. Okay, no matter what people say in the literature, no matter how many people get this wrong, please understand, if there's more than one aromatic sextet, it's not an acene. The other side is that as the acene grows, you see a surprising acceleration in properties. There are a few other compounds where just adding one more ring leads to such a dramatic shift in homo-lumo gap. Unfortunately, a dramatic decrease in solubility as well as a decrease in stability. So this is what we find. The electronic properties become more interesting as the rings get longer, but the negative properties, solubility, stability, become more difficult to solve. So on the electronic side of things, the way most electronic devices work is you've got a physicist or an engineer who is well-equipped, beautiful facilities, everything's nice and clean, and they use photolithographic techniques to pattern these beautiful electrodes, and then we organic chemists come and we just hurl random molecules, garbage, over these beautifully patterned electrodes. And we hope that they arrange themselves such that they will modulate charge transport from one electrode to the other in the way that we want. If I'm making a field effect transistor, for example, I want very close contacts between molecules. I want this charge to move very quickly across. If I'm making an OLED, for example, it's a slightly different configuration, but there, I want charges to move a bit more slowly because we need time for them to recombine and emit. And so, you never make a device that is just one molecule spanning the electrodes. So it is really important to understand that it's the intermolecular interactions that will define the performance and properties of the film once it's in the solid state. Right? Understanding a single molecule is not so helpful. So we look, for example, at the way we teach our undergraduate students an aromatic ring. I have a sigma framework. I have this beautiful pi electron cloud above and below. But that's not so helpful because if we're talking about charge transport, particularly whole, right, I want to move a cation from one end to the other. Well, I'm extracting that electron, I'm generating that hole in the highest occupied molecular orbital. And rather than a very diffuse, puffy electron cloud, I've got a very well-defined array of areas of high orbital density and areas of zero orbital density. I have lobes and I have nodes. And depending on the properties we want, I may want to have a molecule that interacts with a strong interaction between the lobes, or I want to have extremely weak interactions, a lobe to a node. Again, this is going to depend on the application I have in mind. And this is actually critical to be able to tune this. And probably one of the most easy ways to visualize the critical impact of solid-state order is on something as simple as an absorption spectrum. Okay, I can measure an absorption spectrum in solution. I can calculate an absorption spectrum in solution. But every device we want to make, its critical performance is in the solid state, in the condensed phase, in the thin film. And I can look at two molecules with identical chromophores. There's two pentosine molecules, just slightly different functional groups. You see their absorption spectra in solution are nearly identical, but I take that from solution to the solid state. This molecule, because of solid state interactions, has a dramatic red shift. This molecule does nothing. Okay? So I can't even get a correct thin film absorption spectrum unless I know the solid state order, unless I know the crystal packing. In the case of charge transport, things are even more intimately defined by solid state order. So the Bredow group has done some beautiful work to demonstrate that if I take two molecules, these are anthradithiophenes, if I start with them perfectly cofacial, I get very strong electronic coupling. If I slide these along the long axis, less than 2 angstrom distance, and I go to 0 electronic coupling. They're still face-to-face, they're still pi-stacked, but just because of the way the orbitals and the nodes align, a small shift can lead to a huge change in the electronic coupling. So again, you cannot predict charge transport unless you really know the solid state order of the material. The solid state order is critical. It's got to be maintained. And the best way to do that is in a single crystal. Right? Not only does this allow us to analyze the solid state order to within 1/10 of an angstrom precision, it allows us to maintain that order. Right? I get a crystal structure, I know exactly what the order of the molecules is. As long as that structure is maintained in the thin film, which is fairly easy to confirm, I have a pretty good certainty that when I try to compare performance in a device to the structure of the molecule, I'm making an accurate comparison. And that's very, very important. So when my group started out, we started with pentosine, which was sort of the hot molecule of the time in the late 1990s. And what we decided to do was to break up the edge-to-face interactions by putting substituents in the middle of the molecule, right? So we wanted to shift from edge-to-face to face-to-face stacking. Now, up until we kind of got into the game, the way people did this was by attaching alkyl groups directly to the pentosine. And our thought, I don't know if anyone here has a dog, but you know, if you take your dog for a walk, you don't grab it by the neck and do, right? You put it on a leash. So the dog has some freedom to do what it needs to do, and you have the freedom to do what you need to do, and you're tethered. And so our real introduction was to use this spacer, right? A very sterically undemanding, flexible spacer to separate the group that does the solubilizing and controls the crystal packing away from the group that does all of the important electronic properties. Okay, so the simple alkyne, and I cannot tell you how long it took us to get the first paper published because, and I quote the reviewers, everyone knows that triple bonds are unstable in electronic devices. And it took us more than 18 months to finally get that first paper out, and now everybody's using this. And it's a little bit heartwarming, but also a little bit depressing. You want people to know how hard I had to fight to get this into the literature so that you people can now use this functionalization scheme. But we actually have a beautiful cabinet. We call it the yellow cabinet. This is just full of alkynes. And whenever we start with a new chromophore, a new system we want to optimize, you know, the student's job, that's what we say in the group, go to the cabinet. And they go and they select a variety of these systems. They make derivatives. We synthesize a lot of derivatives. We are synthetic chemists. You will not be able to tell that from my talk. Because as usual in organic electronics, all of the synthesis goes into the supporting information, and anyone only cares about the structure. But we'd make a lot of molecules, and the reason is it's very, very difficult to predict crystal packing. So you have to make a whole bunch of derivatives and start trying to make judgments about how to tune a chromophore. So we came up with a very simple model about 15 years ago. That relates roughly the size of the solubilizing group that we use versus the width of the acene. And for a small ratio, if the group is small, we get one-dimensional pi stacks. When we get the group just right, we get this two-dimensional stacking we call the brickwork, like bricks in a wall. And then if we make it larger still, we move to 1D slip stacks again. And if we make it really, really huge, we get strictly edge-to-face interactions. And in fact, each of these types of crystal packing is good for a different application. So the 1D slip stacks turn out to be good for singlet fission, the 2D pi stacks are great for transistors, and these edge-to-face interactions are fine for OLEDs. So I am a synthetic chemist, I should at least talk a little bit of synthesis, but what I want to emphasize is, I don't know if any of you read organic electronics paper in literature, 80% of them start introducing organic electronics as a low-cost approach to modern electronics. And then they have a 17-step synthesis. And you wonder, okay, 17 steps, really? You're going to call that low-cost? No, no. So back when I was getting into the commercialization of materials, about 2005, Motorola had a metric for commercialization of display materials where they said they could tolerate a materials cost no higher than $17 a gram. Okay, and I can guarantee you that in the last 10 years, that number has gone down substantially. And that's for displays, right? People will pay a premium for this. If you're talking about OPV, people will not pay a premium for a photovoltaic, right? People will pay $12,000 for a 55-inch OLED TV. Nobody's going to pay $12,000 for a 55-inch solar panel, okay? So if you wanted to succeed in OPV, you cut that by about a factor of 10. So $2 a gram, now you're talking a commercially viable OPV material. Okay. For us, we start with the phthalaldehyde, which is used to sterilize surgical instruments. So if you know where to buy it, it's pennies. Cyclohexanedione was an old photographic material. So if you know where the stockpiles are from Kodak closing down, you can get this almost for free. Potassium hydroxide, okay. Ethanol, we make plenty of ethanol in Kentucky, easy to get. This precipitates out beautifully, so you simply filter. You add the alkyne of your choice. So the insoluble material suddenly becomes soluble. You quench with tin chloride. If you do this correctly, this material simply precipitates. You filter and recrystallize. 300 grams, that's an old slide. So here is a 600 milliliter beaker filled with the crude material from one run. So we can make many hundreds of grams of these kinds of compounds easily. Recrystallization is very straightforward. We learn to recycle the solvents. Very, very low cost. So one of the things I will say, I apologize to any synthetic chemists that may be in the audience, but I'm not going to show much synthesis because the whole point of everything we do is to keep the chemistry as simple as possible, because if you're going to be viable in this world, the materials cost has to be ridiculously low. Okay. So let's start talking about applications. Field effect transistors. So I'm guessing people here are familiar with the basic fundamentals of how a transistor works. It's a three-electrode device. I have my gate electrode, source electrode, drain electrode. The semiconductor is laying between the source and the drain. And this is where the solid-state interactions in the material are the critical parameter. How well that charge can move from the source to the drain is going to be directly related to the strength of the electronic coupling between molecules in that film. Okay. So as we started screening materials, we started seeing some interesting patterns. At first blush, at first case, all of our 2D brickwork materials tended to give very good materials. All of our 1D slip stack materials gave relatively poor materials. Now, if you calculate the electronic coupling in these systems, they're very, very similar and fairly high. The real issue here is that the 2D brickwork structure always adopts a layered configuration, right? So here are my pi-stacked acenes. I have the greasy silicon groups, and then the greasy silicon groups from the next layer, and then the pi-stacked acenes, okay? What that means is I can grow one layer on the surface, cover the surface, and then the next layer can grow on top of that, and then the next layer grows on top of that. So I get these beautiful flat films. In the case of the one-dimensional slip stack, so here's the difference, right? I have edge-to-edge interactions between. In 1D slip stack, I have what we call interdigitation, right? This silicon group is to the side of this silicon group. And if you think about how the crystal grows, right? So here I am. I have this molecule landing on a substrate. Where does the next one have to go? I cannot use my pi-stacking neighbor because first I have to add the one that hooks in, that interdigitates, and then the next pi-stacking neighbor can come in. And as I grow more, I've got to hook in again, and then the next pi-stacking neighbor. The take-home here is that when you have these 1D stacks where they link together like that, the film is growing vertically at the same time that it grows horizontally, which means your films are going to look like this. You're going to get long needles. You're going to get very, very poor surface coverage. Because if I have to grow vertically and horizontally at the same time, I'm rapidly consuming my material out of solution. I'm going to deplete the solution very quickly. I'm going to grow a very poor quality film. All right. So it has nothing to do with electronic coupling in this case. This is strictly to do with the way the film grows. So a lot of people have wondered, all right, you're working with crystals and you're talking about flexible electronics. How do you make flexible electronics from crystals? And this is a classic example from Jun Takeya of a pentosine-based transistor, and that's what they called flexible. And it's a vacuum deposited device that then is encapsulated. If you don't encapsulate it with perylene, the film delaminates and it goes down. And we thought that didn't make sense, so we worked with Vitaly Podzorov to make transistors on mylar, simple silver source and drain electrodes, so we're not getting the injection that we want, but very, very straightforward to make. Mobility up to about 0.4, and then we tested bending radius. So we made a very large channel device, and we took various diameters of copper wire, and we would bend the device around the copper wire 10, 20, 30 times and measure it while it's bent and measure it when we flatten it back out. And we didn't see any change in the device characteristics until we got down to a bending radius of 0.1 millimeter. All right, so flexible, this is foldable, this is creasable. 0.1 millimeter bending radius is tiny. So absolutely organic crystals, crystalline films are perfectly suited for flexible electronic devices. We don't have to worry about crystallinity and flexibility competing with each other. The crystals, the films are thin, they're very flexible. So we did one of my startup companies, a fair amount of work with 3M on printed electronics. And this is sort of an early prototype display before they bought out the company and then went secret on us. Strictly printed, we used their inks and our formulation for an ink for the semiconductor, their inks for the conductors. And essentially a plastic transparent sheet goes into one end of their printer and out the other end comes a very low resolution display. It's not a spectacular mobility, but this is early days. Again, this is about 2005, 2006 we were doing this. But again, it's an inkjet printed display. One of the things we were doing with 3M is trying to figure out how to get higher performance out of the materials, make a better material. And so we look at the crystal packing in our pentacenes and we see that we really want to get this stacking partner to move down a bit. Really, that will get us better pi overlap, I think lead to a better material. The interaction that's causing this bump, right, this unfavorable offset, is between the isopropyl groups of just, you know, with the neighboring silicon groups. And actually very recently working with the Clearinghouse group, we've actually come up with some interesting other design rules for ultra-high performance organic semiconductors, which we didn't know about 10 years ago. We wish we did. So again, we look at the crystal structure and to the synthetic chemist's eye, this is pretty obvious, right? This isopropyl group is disordered. That tells us there's space there that needs to be made more compact. And so a couple of chemists and a couple of devices people and their various managers and bookkeepers over the course of 6, 8, 9 months funded the synthesis of derivative after derivative after derivative after derivative, dozens upon dozens of compounds synthesized and tested until we stumbled across this simple version where we replace one of the isopropyl groups with a cyclopropyl, right? And that immediately leads to an increase in the density, which actually, 3M got a mobility of 4. I've been working with other groups on this material in academic sense. We're now up to a mobility of pi 0.8 for a simple pentacene derivative. Okay. So tiny changes in functionalization can have enormous impact on the solid state order, which in turn has enormous impact on the performance of the device. One of the key philosophies of our group is that the group that controls solubility and crystal packing has to be added in the last synthetic step. Because, and I particularly see this with polymer people, it makes me feel very bad for them. You put the solubilizing groups on first so that all your intermediates remain soluble. And the problem with that is if you want to start screening for performance, I've got to do that 5, 6, 8 step synthesis as many times as the derivatives I want. Whereas if you put the groups in last, or if you do something that's modifiable at the end, you basically make a bulk amount of your key intermediate and then one step, one step, one step, one step, one step, and we can make many, many, many derivatives. So we then started looking at heteroatoms, and Howard Katz, quite a while ago, made one of the first non-pentacene derivatives showing good field effect mobility. It's made as a mixture of syn and anti-isomers. And we came in and we applied our functionalization scheme, and we were able to get mobilities 0.5 to 1, so solution cast, very simple. 2005, we reported mobility of 1 in JAX. It was very straightforward. Reliably, we can get 0.5 very easily. We've actually gotten better, but I'll talk about that in a bit. And then we made the step of fluorinating, and adding these fluorine groups, we'll talk about what that does to the crystal packing. The immediate impact was the dramatic increase in stability by blocking those reactive thiophene positions with something nice and small and electron withdrawing. The other thing we noticed is the crystalline films form much more quickly. So without the fluorines, if you spin cast, you get an amorphous film. With the fluorines, when you spin cast, you get a highly crystalline film. Beautiful stuff. And the performance is quite nice. So we get spin cast mobility up to about 1.2. If you drop cast, you get a mobility of about 4. Again, straightforward, simple synthesis. And in fact, we came up with some techniques working with Tom Jackson and Dave Gundlach of actually patterning. So by doing particular surface treatments, we could have these materials. I know this looks ugly, right? See these ugly sort of cloudy bits? Those are the only regions where the semiconductor crystallizes. So this is basically a spin cast film. The film only crystallizes where we put surface treatments down. And so all these areas here are amorphous. These areas over the devices are crystalline. So there's a 130 transistor frequency divider. So solution processed and essentially self-patterning. So organic electronics are really, really convenient. So we worked quite a while to try and tune the materials just like we did with our pentosines. The only thing that ever gave us any success was switching silicon for germanium. The slightly longer germanium carbon bond distance let the molecules settle in a little bit more closely. But one of the main things we found is that it crystallized even more quickly, so it was good for spray casting. So working with the Drucescu group, using a simple airbrush, we can spray cast large areas. We get an average mobility of 2 over 110 devices tested on a single substrate. So it's again, tiny changes. Moving from silicon to germanium, all of a sudden now we can spray cast. Again, beautiful crystalline films from spray casting this material. So in publications and proposal submissions, everyone complained about the fact that we're making this as a mixture of isomers. And everybody knows that mixtures of isomers cannot show high mobility. In my opinion, 6 is pretty high, but apparently mixtures of isomers can't do that. So Jeanan Bao, for example, decided that she was going to fix the isomer problem. She's going to make this molecule. And there's only one isomer. And she was talking to me about this, and I said, it's not going to make a difference because the silicon groups are what control crystallization. The aromatic is just, it's taken for a ride. The silicon groups control it. And so she published this beautiful paper in Chemistry of Materials, but if you go and dig into the supporting information and pull out the crystallographic SIF file, you'll see that, yes, the sulfurs are scrambled over all 4 possible positions. There's no preference. And so it's completely disordered in the solid state. Who cares if you have the pure isomer? And that was our philosophy for the longest time, until my good friend Rick Tikwinski at University of Erlangen went through a very lengthy, I think 11-step synthesis, overall 9% yield, to make the isomerically pure syn isomer. And we compared that in vacuum-grown crystals, the highest quality form you can, with our 2-step 85% yield isomeric mixture. And what we see is that in the solid state, everything is scrambled, they look identical, and in the devices, the performance is about the same. So your choice, 9-step, 9% yield, or 2-step, 85% yield to get a material with the same performance. Right. More recently though, Kazuo Takemiya made the isomerically pure anti-anthodithiophene and showed that its performance was double that of the isomer mixture. Now, on the one hand, you could say, well, that's because it's a pure isomer. But on the other hand, you could say, well, that's more than 10 years later. And in the last 10 to 12 years, we've learned a lot about how to make high-quality transistors. So it could simply be that he's just gotten better at fabricating transistors and not that the material is any better. But a year later, Mamada and co-workers made the syn and anti pure and compared them side by side and found that the pure anti had performance about the same as the mix, but the pure syn was an order of magnitude worse. All right, so finally that got our attention. That's interesting. Let's consider these isomers. So we developed a synthesis going by a desymmetrized precursor to separate the 3 isomers we get in this case. And we got crystal structures at this stage to prove we have the pure isomers, because we know as soon as we make the molecule symmetrical, things are going to scramble. And then it's a very simple matter to fully decidylate and then pop on whatever group we want onto the alkynes. So this is a really nice case where it's very easy to change functional groups with the pure isomers, whatever group you want to put on. And we've got some weird ones, believe me, and we've gotten some nice improvements in performance, but I'm not here to talk about that. I'm here to talk about the impact of isomer purity for now. So again, you see in the solid state there's substantial scrambling, even in the pure isomer, of where the sulfurs lie. And you can go ahead and calculate the electronic coupling. And you see there's almost no difference, 0.113 versus 0.114, right? 1/1000th of an EV difference. Right, but if you make the devices, you get a 2-fold improvement in performance from the pure isomer. No change in electronic coupling. Strange. The germanium devices make the germanium isomerically pure. Again, we see the molecule becomes a bit more dense when it's the pure isomer. We calculate the electronic couplings a bit more, so 0.11 versus 0.102, 0.008 of an EV difference. What does it do to performance? The mixture versus the pure anti, 3-fold improvement in performance, even though the electronic couplings changed almost not at all. Right, now maximum 7.5 centimeters squared per volt second from a fairly straightforward to synthesize material. If you go back to the spray casting, however, the isomeric mixture gave these beautiful films. The pure isomers, garbage. The films are absolutely horrific when they're spray cast. So if you want to spray coat, the isomeric mixture seems to be better. It's got a little more tolerance for rapid drying techniques. So what's going on here? For the longest time, we took after the philosophy of my colleague Mark Watson, who considered sulfur-fluorine interactions as a way that these molecules are attracting each other and making the crystals a bit more dense. But once we got the pure isomer, we saw this is nothing more than a traditional fluorine-carbon-hydrogen bond, right? An aromatic fluorine-hydrogen bond, right? The electron-withdrawing fluorine groups makes this proton more acidic, and so it's much more amenable to a classic side-on fluorine-aromatic hydrogen bond. And that's what's pulling this crystal together. And the interesting thing is, the only way you can get pure hydrogen bonding is if you have the pure anti-compound. The minute you introduce a syn isomer, whether in the pure isomer or in the mixture, I have to introduce these fluorine-sulfur interactions, which are substantially weaker. And that, we think, is one explanation as to why the crystals are more dense and the performance is a bit higher. But that doesn't explain why the electronic couplings that we calculate differ by almost not at all, but the performance is a factor of 3 or 2 different. So there, right, so that's basically a summary of that. Actually, I'll throw this in. This is nice. Ona Dracescu is measuring trap densities, and there's a trap in our anthracyclines, about 0.35 EVs that she measures. And we thought, okay, it's got to be some chemical impurity. So we made the material as absolutely pure, the isomeric mixture, as absolutely pure as we could. And what we did is we got rid of a whole bunch of the low energy traps, but that monster there remained. Ona has this weird technique called vibration-assisted crystallization. So you take the solution and you expose it to low-frequency vibrations while the film's crystallizing, and she can get rid of the trap that way. Another way to get rid of the trap is to send her the pure isomer. We send her the pure anti, that trap disappears. So there's some element of disorder that is disrupted either by vibrating the solution while it's drying or by getting rid of all of the syn isomer. And what we want to do is we want to introduce the concept of the disordermer, right? As these films are crystallizing, every once in a while, right, you're going to get this flip-flop, even if in the pure anti-isomer. So this is pure anti. I can flip over a molecule energetically. That's minimal to do. And I move from having pure fluorine-hydrogen bondings, fluorine-sulfur, boom, I've got a mess. And crystallographically, we can actually calculate the number of these mismatches in the lattice. And in the pure syn and in the mix, it's about 50%, as you would expect for roughly one-to-one mixture. But when we get isomerically pure, we get that disordermer content down to 10%, mobility goes up to 5.7. We get it down to 5%, that's where we get our 7.5. So getting rid of this little bit of disorder, this material that causes a trap, the disorder that causes a trap, has a huge impact on the mobility. So anytime you have kind of an asymmetric molecule, of course in pentosine this would never happen, right? It's got to be, you know, lots and lots of symmetry. You disymmetrize with things like thiophenes and suddenly you have to worry about this kind of disorder. And people are starting to pick up on this term of disordermer, which is cool. Another classic thing to do is to use blends in polymers, and so we work with Thomas Antopoulos on this, with both pentosines and anthodithiophenes. Get a nice mobility, much better reproducibility when you do it as a blend, much nicer film, so you've got to do some special device work, side-top dielectric, things like that. Thomas did this beautiful hybrid device where he did zinc oxide as N-type, and then deposited a blend of our materials as the P-type, to get essentially an ambipolar system, depending on which gate you bias is whether you're looking at the P-type or N-type regime. More recently, we've been working with the Amostian group on formulations in polystyrene, since that's a much cheaper polymer, and we're able to get mobilities up to about 6.7, which is essentially the single crystal limit. Thomas claims with doping he's getting closer, even higher than that. We'll see. But it's, again, a very simple way to make a large area high-quality films by blending the very expensive semiconductor one-to-one with a very cheap polymer. So we'll switch topics now to OPV singlet fission. So it was mentioned earlier today that one of your interests is in the organic photovoltaics area. One of our interests many years ago, a decade ago, was spray-painted solar cell. This was a project with the Department of Defense, DARPA in particular, very aggressive, of all spray-painted devices, and we got it to work on arbitrary surfaces. There's a chip that my postdoc found in his back garden, spray painted a photovoltaic. Okay, power conversion efficiency of 0.25%. You know, consider this is 2005, where 2% was considered pretty impressive, so we weren't too unhappy with that. But the thing that was really upsetting to us was the device stability, and we nailed that entirely down to the presence of the fullerene, right? Out in the field doing a spray painted device, you can't encapsulate. And so the materials themselves have got to be stable. Fullerenes sensitize the formation of singlet oxygen. You make singlet oxygen and any aromatic in the area is dead, right? So the problem with fullerenes is that in the presence of oxygen and light, they make a highly reactive species. So that got us into thinking about non-fullerene acceptors. And we tried for a while with pentosines with the Maliaris group and found that certain crystal packing motifs tended to give very good, well, reasonable performance back then. Other crystal packing motifs were horrible. And this is the motif that tended to work the best. We call this the sandwich herringbone. What you see is you've got this beautiful contiguous pie stacking transport chain that's insulated top and bottom by the greasy groups from adjacent chains. But let's think about this a little bit differently, right? So I'm going to color the electroactive groups in gray and the insulating stuff in pink. And if I think about materials that are good for transistors, our brickwork material, as the crystallite is forming in the polymer matrix, that's what the polymer sees. If I want to transfer an electron from my polymer to that acceptor, I've got to go through that sea of pink insulating garbage. Whereas in all of the systems where efficiency was good, on every crystal face, I see exposed pi surface. And so that thought caused us to consider changing our functionalization strategy. So instead of playing this game where I have a chromophore that has essentially umbrellas of solubilizing groups, let's flip that around. We'll put the solubilizing group on the end, and we'll put conjugated antenna groups in the middle. And so we call these the EHADIs, so the ethyl hexyl anthracene diimides. We've tried other alkyl groups, other solubilizing groups. Ethyl hexyl works the best. And so we start with just the bare compound, the parent, and the device performance is absolutely miserable because this is going to adopt an edge-to-face interaction, and it's going to, again, have this shielding layer of grease. And the Linlu group got back to us and said, oh, this is a horrible material, and we said, yes. And they said, well, why did you send us a material if you knew it was going to be bad? And I said, it's because we're scientists. You're engineers. There's the difference, right? We want to test the negative as well as the positive of our hypothesis. So we add simple aryl groups to break up aggregation, and the device performance improves substantially. Good, we're on the right track. We add an alkyne, but not with an antenna, an alkyne with an alkyl group. And performance goes up again, this time entirely due to an increase in the VOC. The current's about the same, the VOC goes up because of what the alkyne does to the HOMO and LUMO of the molecule. So excellent, we're on the right track. Let's put our first antenna on. And right off the bat, we're at 1.5% with a really, really stable and easy to make molecule. If we look at the crystal packing, we see again, this is a system where no matter what crystal face you look at, you've got exposed pi surface. That's what the polymer is wrapping around, basically. Okay. So again, we continue to play games. Let's put greasy groups on the antenna. Let's block up the antenna sterically. And we watch performance go down by a factor of 5. Okay. Let's make the antenna bigger without adding greasy groups. So we'll go from phenyl to naphthyl, right? This is classic physical organic chemistry. And we go up to about 1.7. Let's make it bigger, phenanthryl. We're now at 2.5%. So now we're competing with fullerenes and P3HT. Let's make it bigger, pyrene. All right, we shouldn't have done that. That was horrible. That was a horrible device. Sometimes, again, I was so embarrassed by that number, it was just wretched. Come on, phone. There we are, 0.02%. So there are still lots of knobs we can tune, still plenty of games we can play, but right now, very simple device, reasonable performance, it's worth playing around. Unfortunately, you cannot get funded to do OPV work in the US anymore, so this is going by the wayside as we focus on other issues like this one. So we used our pentosine as the P-type material with one of Mike Wazlewski's pyrrolidine diimides as the N-type, and we got nothing. And what Mike found, because he's a spectacular photophysicist, is that all of our pentosine is converting itself to the triplet. And once you're in the triplet state, you're no longer high enough energy to do that photo-induced electron transfer to the acceptor. And that was frustrating. Got a nice paper out of it, but that was frustrating. But that got us starting to think about singlet fission. So a very interesting phenomenon where I excite one molecule, and in a bimolecular process, I switch electrons, basically, to make two triplets of half the energy from that one singlet. Why is that interesting? Well, if we think about a photovoltaic of any sort, silicon, cad telluride, whatever you want, right, if I can put a film over it that allows all the low energy photons to pass through, but takes all of the high energy photons and splits them up, I have a way to substantially increase the power output of an already embedded solar cell. And really, this is our ultimate goal. We don't want to do some of the more fancy things that a lot of people are doing. We really do want to make a way to really make 100% two triplets from the singlet that comes in, and then 100% emission of those triplets. And that's the tricky bit. But the calculation is we improve the power output of a traditional solar panel by 20%, Right, and that's no wiring, no electrics. It's a film you put over an embedded cell, right? Just like tinting a window on a car. So again, singlet fission efficiency relates directly to the solid state order of the material. Okay, and we did this a lot of exploration with the friend group, looking at things like tetracene, and how they have shown, I won't say we have shown because this is way above my pay grade, but they have shown that what you see is that as the singlet signal decays, you see an excimer increase, and as the excimer decays, that's when the triplet begins to increase. So it goes through an eximeric intermediate. We've also shown that, for example, in systems where we have minimal pi-pi interactions, singlet fission is extremely slow. Again, order of magnitude increase in speed. Again, here shows pentosine chromophore, different crystal packings, completely different solution versus thin film absorption, right? Solution in black, thin film in green, it's about the same. Here, solution versus thin film, huge redshift, very different change. Significant increase in the singlet fission rate. So the type of interaction you see in these crystals is critical to the rate of singlet fission. And working with Henning Searinghouse on a material that's not even optimized for OPV work. Just looking at making a device with PC71BM, it's not a great device. Power conversion efficiency is barely 2%, but IQE of almost 120%. So we're getting more juice out than light coming in. Again, it's a good signal for singlet fission. It's magnetic field dependent, which suggests that it is involving triplets. And so we think this is, I don't like this approach about building into the PV. I really want to have a system that I can laminate on an embedded silicon solar panel. But again, this is a simple demonstration that we can get some really nice increases in performance by harvesting those triplets. So second to last topic, imaging. We design materials that do not pi stack. By doing so, what we've got are systems where in the solid state, we get bright, bright emission, even in the condensed phase. So let's say I have a mouse with a tumor, and I want to image that tumor. What I want to do is I want to be able to excite at one end of the there's a brief window in mammalian tissue that's relatively transparent to light, and I want to excite, I want to probe at one end of that, and I want to read out at the other end. So I maximize my signal to noise. I don't interfere. I can use a really strong pulse beam and not have to worry about it interfering with the readout, right? In organic materials, you could accomplish this by having an enormous Stokes shift. But I don't know if any of you have played with fluorescent materials and tried to design in a huge Stokes shift. It's not easy. So working with the Prodome group at Princeton, we came up with a different plan. We make these particles, nanoparticles. They have tendrils and exterior that's designed to target tumors. On the interior, we have a mixture of up-converting inorganic nanoparticles and fluorescent materials from my group. So what you want is to excite at 925 nanometers and have the up converters absorbed there. They do their up conversion and re-emit at 462. So we need to design an organic that absorbs strongly at 462 and then emits at the other end of the bioimaging window, right around 700 nanometers. And pentosines don't quite do that. They're getting close, as you can see with this molecule. Just the tail end is starting to emit right around 700. So we need to design a new molecule, and that would be the hexosine, slightly larger. It's highly hydrophobic, which is a good thing. And a lot of people think bioimaging, it needs to be hydrophilic. No, no, no. If I'm targeting a tumor, once I'm targeted, I want my emissive material to stay there. If it's water soluble at all, it turns out the body is full of water. It's going to leach out and it's going to spread all over the place and you've lost your imaging. So it's got to be hydrophobic. The problem is it aggregates. So we've got to put these funny bumpers on the ends to keep it from aggregating and get good solid state emission. So remember I said about keeping the synthesis simple? We are an organic synthesis group. We do a lot of synthesis. And it turns out that in the biomedical arena, $70 a microgram is considered cheap. Right? So it's embarrassing what they'll pay for imaging materials. No wonder so many of my colleagues are in the pharma area. Wow. So again, we are a synthesis group. We do a lot of synthesis and we do it at scale. So we start with 109 grams of naphthalene. And again, we do a beautiful synthesis where we have a nice split at this point where we take it in one direction and we take it in the other direction. Again, this is all out of the head of a great former grad student, Matt Bruzek, who's now on the salary of 3M Corporation. Beautiful synthesis. getting to this, so we start at 109 grams. We ended up with about a gram and a half of this last beast at the end after quite a lot of synthesis. Does it work? Well, first of all, it absorbs very strongly where the up converter is emitting, and it emits beautifully at about 720 nanometers. It does not overlap with the up converter absorption. And yeah, we can image tumors. So this is another reason why I'm not in the bio area. I don't like getting emails like this in my inbox. But one of the key things is that they were used to be using quantum dots to do this, which meant they had to sacrifice the mice. Using an organic system, the mice live. That's an anesthetic cone over its nose. So they actually watched the tumor grow and spread. And they were really overjoyed that they, you know, they can really follow the progression. The cool thing is you're actually imaging a tumor on the spine of the mouse looking through its belly. So you're actually looking through the entire mouse with this technique. What we're trying to do is modify this so that we can use modified military night vision goggles. So forget x-rays, forget MRIs. Think about the cost reduction for the third world of tumor detection of using modified military night vision goggles, which are really easy to get a hold of, alarmingly, to do imaging of tumors. So I want to wrap this up talking about theory. As I hope I've convinced you, the solid state order of a material determines the key and critical properties, whether they're optical or electronic. And if we want to be able to use computers to help us design new materials, at least in the applications we're interested in, we need to have theory that can predict crystal packing, right? So if you think about this work we did with 3M, many months, many people, don't worry about the person hours involved or anything like that. Those of you who do synthesis, think about the amount of chemical waste generated in making dozens upon dozens of derivatives, 90% of which are going to end up going in a drawer never to be seen the light again because they didn't work well. If we could find a way to computationally predict the functionalization we need to get optimum intermolecular coupling, that would shorten the synthesis timescale and substantially reduce waste both of person effort and of environmentally hazardous chemical waste. And so a small group that I've assembled was just funded by the U.S. National Science Foundation in October to do exactly this, to figure out in this class of organic semiconductors, can we predict crystal structure precisely enough to allow the synthetic chemist, and after making only one or two derivatives rather than 30 or 40, nail in the exact crystal packing that we want. In order to do that, the first thing we have to do is understand the interactions that are taking place and can we model them appropriately. So here's the model we developed back in 2002, 15 years ago. Okay? And I have a very young junior faculty colleague who came in on this. He's the computation lead on this project, Chad Risco. And we know the kind of crystal packing we want. And he starts, of course, thinking about this more carefully. Because, again, I'm a synthetic chemist. I'm going to think about things quickly. Can I get an interesting structure synthesized? He wants to think more carefully. How do I get this into a computer in a way that's going to make this a tractable problem? And so, like I say, in the course of about 2 months, he took this model we developed and been using for 15 years and threw it in the garbage can. It's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life. I love it. So here's his start of calculations. Okay, there's the isopropyl group. And remember the thing I said about the width ratios, et cetera, et cetera? Well, according to his computations, if I look at the triethyl silyl group, the numbers are essentially the same, 3.89 versus 3.88. They're essentially the same size, right? Yet one's a 2D brickwork, one's a slip stack. So why? Okay. The big deal is the electron density within that ellipsoid. Because of the isopropyl group, because it's branched, because it's more rigid, it's got more electron density, right? So 0.36 versus 0.26. The other thing is that because these ethyl groups are more flexible, the alkyl CH to aromatic pi interactions start to become more favorable. So he did a lot of modeling trying to understand the balance of exchange repulsion versus induction, electrostatics, and dispersion. So exchange, of course, that's the classic. You can't have two things occupying the same place at the same time, right? You look at dispersion, right? Interactions, changes in fluctuations, things like that. Electrostatics, really not a big worry in these systems. There's no dipole moments or anything like that. And induction, right? Relaxation of one monomer in the response to the mean field of another. Piling all of these terms together, doing multiple analyses. And one of the first things he looked at was the interaction between the alkyl side chains and the interaction distances. Green is the ethyl, red is the isopropyl. And as you can see, the ethyl groups are able to get much, much closer together, closer to each other, before the repulsion takes over, in both cases, whether you're looking at an edge-to-edge, as you see in the brickwork packing, or more of a side-to-side interaction where you see within the stack and in the slip stack packing. They also can model the aromatic-to-aromatic interactions. He and people like David Sherrill have been doing that for many years. That actually is already fairly well known. So putting this all together, again, way above my pay grade, one of the first things that came to me was that, you know, and this is calculated, the transfer integrals in that 1D slip stack of the triethylsilyl derivative, they're much more strongly coupled. Because the triethylsilyl group is smaller, the acenes are able to get closer together. And so the way he played with that is that, well, what if we take the triethylsilyl group that's a 1D slip stack and force it to adopt a 2D brickwork. And we took the tipspenazine, which is 2D brickwork, and forced it to adopt the 1D slip stack. What are the differences in energies? What are the differences in performance? And the thing that kind of inspired him to do this was our good friend Oana Drucescu, working with the Australian group, actually found an acene-like derivative, depending on how the crystals are grown, either adopts a 1D slip stack or a 2D brickwork packing. So it's got two different polymorphs. And the difference in mobility, as you can see, is quite substantial. So he modeled it, and what he found is that if I force these different groups to adopt the opposite crystal packing, 1D going to 2D, 2D going to 1D, the difference in energy is not that large. And in fact, this one that is shown to adopt two polymorphs, it's actually even larger. So he came in and said, you should be able to force this test derivative to adopt the 2D brickwork packing. And then, of course, if it does adopt that, can we calculate the electronic coupling? And in fact, it should be. The valence band dispersion is substantially larger because, again, the molecules are closer together. And the really exciting thing is that Chad reports this, and then within 2 weeks, the Liu group has just discovered that there's a new polymorph of this triethylsilyl pentosine. And so we're now working to get the X-ray data to show whether or not that polymorph is indeed this 2D brickwork and start getting device data on it. So he's predict, and it's nobody's going to believe us because the discovery of the new polymorph came within a few weeks of us predicting there would be one. And we, you know, these are groups that work together already. But honestly, I'm telling you, the computational guy said, hey, there should be a new polymorph. And then I was at the Solvay conference a couple of weeks ago, and Lynn said, hey, we found a new polymorph in your test pentosine. So there was no communication, really. This was a actually unique discovery. And we're really excited because, again, once we can understand these interactions and start predicting polymorphs, we now can start playing around with changing out the alkyl groups and predicting crystal packing, which is what we're going to need to get this done. So I'm going to give you my heavily biased take-home message. It's all about the solid state order, right? If I can predict that and if I can control that, I can make a material that'll do whatever I want. It's beautiful. So I've got to thank the people that do the work. I have to particularly thank Carl Thorley, who is the person who basically said our research group needs to get a lot more theory in it. And I laughed him at first, and I'm thanking him now. The great bunch of people doing all the hardcore synthetic work, the Navy, KAUST, and NSF in particular for funding us. I have to thank NIST for buying us a new building. We're very thankful to them for that. The University of Kentucky Center for Applied Energy Research is where I work. And thank you for your attention. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, John, for an amazing talk. Do we have any questions? Hugo.
Amazing talk, John.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. The question is that it's, have you guys ever tried, or are you guys trying to do any co-crystals with your pentosine stuff?
Yeah. From the simple idea of, so we take tipspenazine and octafluorotipspenazine, and we find that there are certain blend ratios that are favored on one end to the other end of trying to co-crystallize with dopants. So if we crystallize with a modified version of F4-TCMQ, we can get conductivities of like 10 Siemens per centimeter. So it's really fun. That is way beyond the computational stuff because that's even harder to predict. But we've played around quite a bit with that, and it's interesting, very interesting. So we're heading into the thermal. I didn't talk about thermal conductivity at all, but that's the next area we're playing with is thermoelectrics and trying to understand how we can modify thermal conductivity with additives co-crystallizing, absolutely. But that is a huge parameter space. There are so many things to do.
But if you mix together, say, TES ADT and the fluorinated one.
Oh, yeah.
Crystallize it. Do you get a co-crystal?
Excellent question. So what we find, and that pair of materials in particular, we've actually published a few papers on this, the F-TES ADT essentially acts as a nucleating agent for the TES ADT. So by blending the F test in various ratios, we actually control the grain size of the test ADT. If we get too much F test ADT, then F test ADT crystallizes, the test ADT remains amorphous, and nothing happens. But if we have, you know, 1-2% additive of F tests, we can actually control the grain size over three orders of magnitude just by the blend ratio. So absolutely, yeah, it's again, huge parameter space there.
Thanks for a very good talk. I'm just thinking about these predictions. You used DFT. I was wondering if you tried any type of machine learning approaches there.
That is one of the aspects. That's not an area where we have expertise, and maybe we should talk. But one of the reasons we chose this class of molecules is that we have hundreds of crystal structures of derivatives with just tiny changes in functional group.
So you would be open to dig into the experimental database
yes.
you have? Okay,
yes.
Excellent.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
So in modeling these crystal structures, you're using DFT. Do you have problems with van der Waals forces? I assume that you're using Grimm forces as an addition to the.
Well, in fact, you just jump back to the appropriate slide. So the coupling energies are from DFT. In the case of the actual molecular interactions, we're not going at quite as high as DFT, right? So we were doing PM7.
Oh, okay.
Right. So no, we only move to DFT when we've got a structure we think is optimized, and then we do the electronic calculations by DFT. But for figuring out what the structures are, we don't go through DFT.
Okay.
That would be way too computer intensive. It would make everyone else using computers at our university very angry with us.
So I guess the reason why you don't use longer racines is that they are not stable, you say. But as far as I learned, you have a ground state, closed shell singlet state in all the molecules. And I guess some molecules are open shell singlet.
So we have suggested in a publication in Angewandte Chemie, we have the only crystal structure of a non-acene. And we have suggested that it is open shell. So at 9 rings, we are quite confident it is open shell.
But that you can't use for applications then?
No, you can't. And in fact, so we actually have gone to hexacene. We've made OPVs. We've made transistors from hexacenes. And as far as I know, that's the largest acene that can be used in applications. We have tried, and in my group's probably one of the experts in acenes. We have tried with heptacene and have never had anything stable enough for even testing charge transport, let alone talking about real applications. So pentacene really is as large as you can practically get and still have enough stability for applications.
And it's not wrong to assume that this has to do with the ground state, that this is closed shell or open shell.
With the evidence I have, I think that is exactly correct. Okay. I think it is entirely an issue of open shell, closed shell, yes. Other people will argue against me, but our evidence from years of working with acenes suggests that it is an open shell versus closed shell issue. Absolutely right.
Maybe I can ask a very quick
sure.
question. When you were talking about spray coating and the isomerically pure material in the isomeric mixtures, you said pure material coated very badly.
Yes, yes.
Do you have an idea of why that was?
We think it crystallizes too quickly. So once it finds a nucleation site, everything seems to want to agglomerate on that site and grow in weird strands coming off of that. Whereas in the isomeric mixture, it slows down a bit. It's still fast, but it slows down a bit. The other issue is that, again, I didn't go into this for time, but the way the spray coating is done is she sprays down one coat, lets it dry, and then another coat on top, lets it dry. So every time you spray another coat on top, you're actually loosening the original material. You're solvent annealing it. And we think that the pure isomer is bound so tightly because of those hydrogen bonds that it doesn't loosen up when it's wet with solvent and anneal. We think that is probably the key issue.
If we have no other questions for John, let's just thank him one more time for a superb talk.